I'm going to try not to, like, spend a lot of time on this. Especially because it's not clear that anyone will be listening.
I don't see how they could be.
I'm going to try to, like,
not... Like, maybe if they're accidentally subscribed.
Yeah, I mean, if someone failed to unsubscribe, as they should have, at the appropriate time, then maybe they would accidentally find this in their feed and be, I guess, most likely annoyed.
I have to assume.
Do you know when the last one of these we did was?
It's been a long time.
Do you want to venture a guess?
Like 2021?
No, interesting. I wondered if you'd lose a year in the other direction. 2022.
Hmm.
May 27th, 2022. We had done something like 60 episodes.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, there were quite a few. Yeah, and that doesn't include the short ones either. Like something like that many main episodes. It would be a good gag to just pretend that no time has passed and we're continuing to do this.
Yeah, I mean, I think that is the conceit. And also, I mean, we're acknowledging that this is simply the continuation of the regular installments of our podcast, CD Business, which is about businesses that sell CDs.
Yeah, this is
Compact Disc.
This is CD Business. We have a bunch of ideas variants on this. And I really pushed for some of the other ones, but you begged me to start with one that wasn't revolting. So this is...
No, I don't think we should ever acknowledge the format.
Okay, fair enough.
I think we should just assert that, as it always has been, this is a podcast about the compact disc business.
Okay. Allison, do you have thoughts on what's in the garden?
Then let us cultivate our garden. It's the only way to make life endurable. What's
in the garden? All right.
We don't have a garden.
No, we don't have anything.
We don't have anything. We have one...
Dead
kumquat tree.
In our living room.
It has like three leaves comically still on it that look like they're going to fall off any second.
The grapefruit rootstock that it is on appears to be growing some new leaves. So I'm curious to see.
I'm just going to caution you. This is outside of our content area now, but continue.
I'm just curious to see if maybe it somehow makes a recovery based on the photosynthesis happening in those tiny grapefruit leaves.
Yeah. Do you want to... You're going to make me bleep a lot of this. What can we say about the intervening 2 years of life in between and then and now? You knew we lived in Florida.
Yeah. Well, so relevant to why the kumquat tree is dead,
we live in the Great White North now.
We recently moved north. So about 2 months ago,
yeah,
we moved north, and about 6 weeks after that, the tree began showing signs of extreme distress.
Well, we drove it here in the packed like a moving truck, and we packed the tree into the moving truck. It was deprived of light for several days straight, and
also it was freezing.
It was
cold.
Under freezing temperatures as we were driving it. So yeah. I was shocked that we didn't open it up and find it to be dead immediately. But it thought about it and decided that I should die.
I mean, citrus trees are quite hardy and are really good at making a comeback from even like a major branch break or something. So I figured even if it got damaged in the move, that it had a good chance. But
it
I just
fine for the first we harvested the kumquats off of it and they were good, as it turns out.
Yeah, they were good.
Because we stressed it out so much, we really juiced the sugar into the... This is my... I don't have any basis on which to believe this, but I believe that because we...
We moved it with fruit on it.
We moved it with fruit on it. We subjected it to enormous stress, so it like squirted out all of its good sugar into the fruit, and then the fruit was really good. As a biologist, you... Is that how it works?
I'm not a plant biologist. Mm-hmm.
But you are a professor of biology now.
assistant professor of biology.
Yeah, well, that's how it works. I mean, if you had gained full professorship from postdoc in the last 2 years, that would have been unprecedented.
Yeah, I just, the other day I was consulting with someone who was like outside the university, but was like helping me with some of my retirement benefit setup. Yeah. And she was like, you're an assistant professor.
Yeah.
But like,
you're the secretary to a professor.
Yeah. Wow, we really should change the name.
Yeah.
It's bad.
Yeah. You are a PI. You have your own lab. You have a budget and employees.
Yeah. It's all true.
Yeah. Here's what you don't know, dear listener. Allison's career has thrived in the last couple of years.
I mean, against...
Against
all odds. All odds, truly.
Yeah. We live in New Jersey. You probably don't want me to say
that.
That's
going a little too far.
Should I bleep your new...
I think you should say we live in the tri-state area.
We live in the tri-state area.
Which tri-state?
We fought about this recently. You can see the skyline of a major American city from our 12th floor window.
All true.
Yeah. You don't care about my career, but I am gainfully employed, you should know. I immediately became gainfully employed once we got here.
Congratulations.
In other life news, the first time I said this, I think that you scoffed, but I'm going to say it again, and I think that you will scoff less. My health anxiety has gone down quite a bit.
I'm glad to hear that.
That doesn't mean I don't still take a lot of pills.
Well,
but I'm not worried about dying all the time, even though it remains just as possible.
I mean, arguably only more so.
More so, yeah. But this, I feel like, is a major improvement in my life. And it's not because COVID's any better, by the way. It's still bad, despite what anyone thinks.
The CDC says you can now spit directly into each other's mouths.
Yep. Yeah, they're advising it.
The CDC says you don't have to wash your hands when you poop.
What should you do with the poop? What do they want you to do with the poop on your hand? First of all, wait a minute. I don't poop on my hands. Sorry, I didn't mean to imply that I poop directly onto my hands. But we all... What do they want us to do with the trace amounts of poop that's on our hands?
Listen, the CDC...
They want us to deposit it on doorknobs and into our eyes and mouths.
Yeah, the CDC says you can now drink, I didn't know if I was going to go with raw water or unpasteurized milk, because I think the FDA is in charge of
I was talking to Nate about raw water today. I don't think that ever made its way out of the West Coast. I've never seen any mention of it here, but raw water was a phenomenon like a year or two ago.
Horrible.
You know, when you just pucker your lips upright to a stream and just suck it down.
The CDC says you don't have to cook meat. You can eat raw meat.
So, Allison.
Are you ready for now? 17 of today's hottest superstars in one all-new Power Pack collection. Move into a new dimension with the year's biggest songs.
That is what I was hoping for. I was most excited to know which one had mbop on it.
You can have all your favorite hits right here, right now. Chart toppers from KZ and JoJo. Aqua.
Fuck yes.
And Spice Girls. Now delivers nothing.
I want that.
Well, it's probably it's available for a very high price. This is a good song. I'll fight that fight.
Now, on CD or cassette.
$17.98.
In the year 1998. That was, in fact, you were wondering which one that was on?
Wait, let me guess. I was going to guess 7 would have mbop.
Wow. This is the very first one.
It's the first one. It's the canonical, now that's what I call music.
Well, this is the very first American one.
Mm.
So, ladies and germs, this is CD business. Today we're talking about Now That's What I Call Music. So this is, that was the advertisement for the first American, now that's what I call music.
What year was that?
1998.
Damn it, I wanted to guess.
All right, well, we can do some more guessing in a little bit. But you may be surprised to learn that the UK had now that's what I call music. How many years do you think before the American version?
7?
15 years. In the year 1983 was the first Now That's What I Call Music.
And it was like a UK. Cassette tape?
It was an LP.
Oh, shit.
Yeah. So the extremely weird story of the naming of this, are you familiar with it?
I mean, I never thought about the naming of it. Okay. Now That's What I Call Music.
So Now That's What I Call Music was a collaboration.
Wait, it's defunct?
No. It continues.
Okay.
But it was initially a collaboration between specifically Virgin Records and EMI. And it was named when Richard Branson, famous adventuring billionaire, is he still alive? Of like Virgin Airlines.
No, probably.
He's done crimes, I think. You probably should look this up. I don't want to talk about him without acknowledging what I assume are serious allegations against him.
Wow.
Just give a quick Richard Branson check.
All right. Let me tell you some things about Richard Branson.
Okay.
He's currently alive, as far as I can tell.
Oh, you know, I was confusing him with the guy who made that antivirus software. What is it called?
Oh, yeah.
Not
Norton Antivirus.
No, not Norton. The other one. McAfee. Yeah, McAfee. I was confusing Richard Branson with McAfee. McAfee was the one who like did murder
in South
America.
He did a bunch of very
fucked
up weird shit.
And did like Bitcoin shit. He's dead. Richard Branson's alive.
Yeah, he's alive. His years active, according to Wikipedia, 1966 to present.
Yeah.
He also is the third oldest person to fly to space.
Oh, wow. He's been to space?
In 2021, he was on a Virgin Galactic suborbital flight, which, frankly, I don't think they should let them count that as going to space.
I agree.
Here are the sections of his Wikipedia page.
Is there a controversy section?
Well, I want you to guess what are you alleging Richard Branson has done?
I think he's done, I'm sorry, but he's done a sex crime, right?
Well, let me just read you the list of sections. Early life, early business career, Virgin, failed business ventures, world record attempts, television, film, and print, humanitarian initiatives, politics, honors and awards.
Here we go.
Tax evasion. Personal life, influences, bibliography, notes, and references.
Well, if tax evasion is, that's a, every billionaire does tax evasion. Come on. All right. Well, he's a hero then. So he's...
No further inquiry needed.
He is responsible for the naming of Now That's What I Call Music in the following way. He gave the founder of Virgin Records, Simon Draper, a novelty postcard that had a picture of a pig looking over a fence, like leaning over like, like he's really enticed by what's on the other side of the fence. And on the other side of the fence is a singing chicken. And the pig is saying, "Now that's what I call music."
I mean, you've just described a Far Side
comic. It's a Far Side comic. That's right. So.
Or like maybe a New Yorker cartoon, yeah,
that
actually.
Is more a New Yorker
the inscrutability
cartoon.
Of it.
That's right. I guess I could post a link to this, or you can just Google it. It's easy to find.
Do you think if I drew a doodle of that, I could get the New Yorker to accept
it? To run it de novo?
To let them think that I wasn't.
I think you could do that every 3 years and get them to, get them to run it again. I mean, it's gold. But yeah, that's then the founder of Virgin Records.
And that was his eureka moment.
Yeah, that's right.
It hit him.
Yeah.
Sometimes that's how the muse operates.
So here's the thing.
Sing, oh muse.
So you sort of buried the lead a little earlier, but now that's what I call music is still happening. They're on, as of November 2023 in the UK, they're on Now That's What I Call Music 116. And in the US, as of January 2024, they're on Now That's What I Call Music 89. There are also series from various other countries throughout the world. It's worth noting.
Okay, so that's a modest 3.4 Now That's What I Call Music releases per year, approximately.
Obviously, they don't have like the cultural capital that they used to, but what I read was that if you based charting, like chart ranking, what is it called? Yeah, charting. Charting. If you based your position on the chart exclusively on physical media these days and not on streaming at all, that they would still be winning a lot of the time. Yeah. Mm. Like they're still doing extremely well for people who want 20 songs on a CD.
I bet. Yeah. I mean, that's what people want if they want a CD, right? If they want an album, people are back to a vinyl record.
Sure.
And if they want the music, they are going to go digital.
Yeah.
So if they want a CD, I mean, they definitely don't. I just want to know, what are the 20 best songs of the last 4 months?
Yeah, I mean, I'm interested in going through some of these and sort of progressing to the point where I know none of the songs. I'm wondering what year that will be.
Yeah.
So yeah, the format for the first three albums was just LP. And then they introduced...
Maybe this is... Okay, you did a little personal project last year where you listened to one album every week.
That's right.
That was new...
So I was still working at the church at that point, and I had like a lengthy drive there and back. So my it was actually a New Year's resolution, was to listen to the previous year's, so it would have been 2022, Pitchfork top 50 albums, not the defunct Pitchfork now, right? Did they fucking shut them down like they did every other? But yeah, I was going to listen to the top, not that I think it is an objective truth that those are the top 50 albums.
It's just a list of 50.
It's a list of 50 things. Albums that, like, probably some of them are at least good on there. So, yeah, I did that.
So, maybe your next project should be to listen to all Now That's What I Call Music collections.
I mean, that I'm afraid might drive me insane.
I will say that commercial that I must have heard literally 500 times as an early teen.
Well, you may be alighting some of them in your mind, because I'll have you know that the guy who voices them has voiced them since 1992 and still voices them. There's one guy who does all the advertisement voiceovers for that.
Nevertheless, the one with Hanson, I've always, like last night when we were talking about doing this, I was like, I wonder how many they were up to when they got to the one with Hanson that I heard
That is iconic. And of course, that's the first one in the US. There's not a number associated with it. They talked about dropping the numbers at one point because, like, I don't know, if you're naming something 116, then it's like, well, is this for old people, right?
Yeah, obviously it's for old people.
But apparently there's some like adoption of it by youth culture.
I just think you could put that collection that was displayed on that commercial, you could just put that on right now at a party. I mean, at least a party if people are age.
We're 40, so yeah.
But the thing is, I think that people in their early 20s are into music.
Mbop,
yes.
Ironically?
I think non-ironically. I think now, with the distance of time, they're into music from the 90s that's just fun. Like, remember a couple summers ago how all of the summer undergraduate students were really into Backstreet Boys?
Do remember that, yeah.
I think that's... Listen, we're old people talking about what young, speculating on what young people are
I know
into.
What they like. And it's skibbity toilet.
No, that's not what 20 somethings like. That's what.
Listen, we're
going to. That's what 8-year olds like.
I'm going to find a way to shoehorn skibbity toilet into this podcast and a subsequent episode, but we'll get to that.
Never.
My curiosity is, if I played for you the advertisement for Now That's What I Call Music Volume 2, if that would be like, oh yeah, that one's iconic in my mind too, right?
I mean, probably all these songs are iconic in my mind because I was 13 years old or whatever.
Well, let's take a listen to that one real quick.
Like, now, these were played at my middle school dances, yeah, exactly. For sure.
Here's Volume 2.
The wait is over. Now 2 has arrived. With you, I lose my mind. 18 chart-topping hits, all in one mind-blowing collection.
Are you asking me if Hit Me Baby One More Time is iconic? Yes!
I'm interested if you remember the commercial. Here's Backstreet Boys.
Yeah. These are the songs I crave.
Boy, Garbage hasn't aged as well as the other. Oh God, I haven't heard this in a long time.
The crew.
Wow, I'm surprised that was 1999 and not 1993 or something.
Wow. Yeah, I mean, I think I do remember this commercial.
Yeah, I remember I probably remember the first dozen of these.
The hottest tracks of the year, all of one essential album.
Wow.
This song rules, actually. I mean, what a great idea.
I have become 100% convinced, in a way that I did not understand at the time, that all DJs hired for middle school dances just played Now That's What I Call Music, collected $200, and went home.
New order. Call the number on your screen or send check or money order for $15.98 for cassette or $17.98 for CD. Plus shipping and handling to the address below.
No inflation on that first to second disc anyway.
Well, that, I mean, Now That's What I Call Music.
You like this music more than I do, I think.
Yeah, I think that at the time when I was, again, literally 13.
Yeah.
I was interested in being too cool to like this music.
Yeah.
But now that I'm old, I can admit that these are fucking bops.
Yeah, I mean, you were
Bop is a bop.
It is. Yeah, it's good.
It says it right in the name.
I think you were cooler than I was from an early age. You did get kicked out of school for weed smoking, which is one of the coolest things that can happen to a person. I think you were cooler than I was from. I feel like I did enjoy these at that time, and now I have I've aged out of them, or there's no amount of distance between the last time I heard Backstreet's Back All Right or whatever, and now that it still wouldn't feel overplayed or oversaturated to me. Like, it's impossible for it to feel fresh again. That doesn't mean I can't appreciate it as music, but
I mean, I did not super long ago drunkenly try to make you watch the music video for Backstreet.
I did it dutifully.
Yeah, but you were definitely not as into it as I was. I was very into it at the time.
I think that the Britney songs have aged better than the Backstreet Boys songs, personally.
Even, I will say this, even by the time I was in college, people were like, oh yeah, Britney Spears is actually very good.
Mm, yeah.
Right. Like, but it became you would distance yourself and you'd be like, well, it's the joke is that you would say, well, it's well produced. And that way you didn't have to admit that Britney Spears was really fucking great.
Yeah.
It was like an irony about irony.
I didn't do you know, as I think with all of these upcoming podcasts, I didn't do like a huge amount of research into this or whatever, but I was curious. My essential question was like less how are the songs picked for the year, because that seems obvious, but how are the songs curated on the disc? Like, like you have to decide on an order and, you know, like that.
Yeah, that Casey and JoJo's got to come at the right point in the middle school dance.
Exactly. And, you know, we all at that point made mixtapes for our friends and our crushes or whatever. And like curating an order was like crucial for like that was.
It's the main thing.
It's the main thing. That's your part in the creation.
Okay, I had a mixtape that someone made for me that had like songs recorded off the radio.
Yeah, I did that.
Where one of the songs was Amish Paradise.
Well, that's weird because was that played on the, were Weird Al songs played on the radio?
Yeah, on the, I mean, some of them, yeah, I mean, they get radio wide releases.
I mean, like Weird Al's wonderful. We all recognize that. But
one of the songs on it was Amish Paradise. One of the songs was Alanis Morissette's Ironic.
Okay.
I wish I still had that mixtape to know what else was on it.
Thematic interaction between those things. I want to read you what I learned about the curation of these, but I did want to go back to what I was going to say a second ago, which is so the they were LPs for the first three albums. Then they transitioned to CDs and tapes. Now 43 through 48, you could get on mini disc. That was during the era of mini disc. Yeah.
That was when I was in high school, right?
Yeah, that sounds about right. Yeah. And the last one you could get on cassette was now 64 in the year 2006. That was the last cassette.
I really was hoping you'd say 69.
And we're still going with CDs to this point, although you can get it on streaming too, which doesn't seem to make a lot of sense to me, but. Because why not just...
I mean, just tell me what the track list is exactly. And I'll make my own playlist.
Exactly. Okay, so I found some quotes by the person who's been producing these for basically the entire time. His name is Jeff Mosco. He talks about these like they are... Like his part in them is art.
Hell yeah.
He says, I look at every album like a painting, and the songs are the individual colors of paint.
Fuck yeah.
He says, we've done a lot of research over the years, and basically what the consumer has said is that they do like their tempos together. So they try to group the songs on an album by tempo. Maskow says, now tends to group ballads in a loose cluster near the middle. So they start with the, I saw in another place they were saying like the first half dozen songs are like, that's how they get you, right? They always front load it with the like six or so like biggest bops of that time. So you will get them all at the beginning. Then they group ballads in a loose cluster near the middle and add a few country songs near the end.
Huh. Oh, is there, there's a now, that's what I call music, that has Kissed by a Rose,
I'm
right?
Sure. Yeah, we can get to
I
it.
I want to know which one.
This next thing. So for sonic reasons, they, you know, he says that some people hate country music, so they put those at the end, but some people like it, so they want to have them be present.
I don't understand. Why are they part of this? I just thought this was a collection of top 40s.
They're trying to appeal
I thought
to
it was
everybody.
Like a top 40s thing. I didn't realize it was a meant to be.
What I gotta read this next sentence. What we go for, Moscow continues, is what I call, quote,
music.
is what I call, quote, the ache with a capital A. The ache.
Whoa.
Which is, you make this and it sounds so good, you want to eat it. Like, it sounds so perfect that you listen and go, God, that really flowed great, man. That sounded fantastic. The intensity of this curation extends even to the space between tracks, which is much briefer than on a normal single artist CD, to better mimic the dead air averse flow of a radio station. So they use less space between tracks to make it seem like it's on the radio.
So this also is something you would do if you were a radio DJ and a top 40s, like a local top 40 station, and you were like, I gotta smoke a cigarette. Let me just put this on.
Yeah, let these flow into each other, right? Like, of course, it's like one of the main skills of a DJ to like tempo match stuff and transition accordingly. It seemed like they try to do a little bit of that on these albums. Let's see, here's Now 3.
Right about now, are you ready for the only hit collection?
Fuck yeah. Yep, iconic.
It's Now 3, all the hits, right here, right now, on one unbeatable...
Yeah, this is in Austin Powers.
I mean, I'm sure all of these were in Austin Powers.
Featuring the biggest names in pop music today, including the Backstreet Boys, Lenny Kravitz, Limp Bizkit, Blink 182, and Smash Mouth.
Yeah. Wow.
All-Star still has such a hold on the culture to this day.
Because of Shrek.
Because of Shrek.
Which I've never seen.
Whoa.
What do you think is the first Now That's What I Call Music without Britney Spears?
Call the number on your screen or send 1798 for CD or 1598 for cassette.
Still 1798.
How many CDs in do you think they got before they didn't have any more Britney Spears?
Wake up with 18.
Whoa.
Here's number four.
You're not listening to my question.
No, I am,
you're
but ignoring it flowed into the next one.
It flowed into the next one.
As they said, I don't know. I guess we'll see.
Wait, the next one also has Smash Mouth? How can there...
You think there's only one Smash Mouth song?
Well,
sort of, yeah.
No, I know there's not because my sister had a Smash Mouth CD.
Album?
Yeah, she had the CD that was, I assume, their only important studio album.
Yeah, you have to understand that probably this one came out 3 months after the last one. So it's just another song from their album,
same album,
whatever their next single was. Here we go with number four.
Are we allowed to just play all of these?
Who gives a shit? Who gives a shit? Oh, yeah.
One incredible CD with the Backstreet Boys, Jennifer Lopez, and Mandy Moore.
So they all have Backstreet Boys. Wow, Mandy Moore! I forgot about Mandy Moore.
Did she die? I thought she died.
No! I'm sure she's just living her life. Yeah.
Well, I made a joke about this recently. That you had that blue lipstick on.
Oh yeah, you did reference that.
I said, "Are you look blue, da be dee da na da 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 da."
Yeah.
It was hilarious.
Wow.
Now that's what I call
Britney's on number four.
Including Eiffel 65, Britney Spears, and Macy Gray.
God. This Macy Gray song is good.
You know what? This entire Macy Gray album is good.
Yeah.
Actually, she's actually great.
I feel like the Britney songs have been the star of each of these so far.
Britney Spears has not released a single that is
subpar.
Yeah. Mm. Ever, right? I mean, she just had a huge span of time where she released no new music, but like all of her singles are good.
Yeah, they are. I don't know if I have any additional information about this. Madonna's never been on one.
She's too.
Until number 116, the one that just came out.
Does it have a new Madonna
song
on it?
It doesn't. She's just a featured artist on someone else's song.
Okay, well.
But throughout the 80s and 90s, Madonna was never on one. Michael Jackson was only on two of them in the 80s, and they were for like nondescript songs I've never heard of.
Yeah, I mean, he was a savvy businessman, I guess.
Yeah, I think that's probably the reason,
right? Like,
for
he
Madonna
was good
too
at making money.
Yeah.
I mean, he was good at a lot of things, but one of them was making money.
Yeah. Here's number five.
This is the story of...
Wow,
now
yes.
That's what I call music, volume five. absolutely the best music of the year with 9 Days and NSYNC. It's gonna be your favorite CD.
It's gonna be me. It's my life. It's now or never.
Now that's what I call music volume 5.
Did you see Griffin McElroy refer to Bon Jovi as John Bovey recently?
I did. Did you hear a weird sound in your headphones when that was playing?
It's because these are terrible encodings of old. The YouTube video. Yeah.
It's like someone taped this onto a VHS they digitized it and then they put it on YouTube.
It's impossible to avoid that. But
the biggest hits from the biggest stars.
Oh, yeah. Destiny's Child,
yeah.
Jump in CD with Destiny's Child, Everclear, Janet, and Mystical. Shake It with Jessica Simpson.
Watch yourself! Yeah. Watch yourself!
Right, and so they're all radio edits also.
Absolutely, they're radio edits, yeah.
Again, this is what the DJ puts on when they're like, I need to go smoke a couple cigarettes and then probably take a shit.
That's what I call music volume 5.
Well, Cisco's on this one?
Yeah, I just saw that name floating by.
I mean, it's
got to
be that one. But they haven't played it. You would think they would play. There's Britney. Damn, this song's good too.
Biggest hits, including Britney Spears, Three Doors Down, and BB Mac. All the hits, all the music on one super CD. It's never sounded so good. Now, That's What I Call Music Volume 5. To order Now, That's What I Call Music Volume 5, call the number on your screen or send 1898 for
one CD. Wow, I mean, these are all.
Oh, it's gone up. Volume 5 has gone up by $1.
Well worth it.
Well worth it. I don't know, they listed Cisco, but didn't play Thong Song. Did he have another song?
Doubtful.
You may have noticed that Janet Jackson was on there, but they referred to her as just Janet.
That was true on a prior one.
I was going to tell you one of the facts I learned that about Now That's What I Call Music is for some reason they only ever credit her as Janet, which it makes me think that maybe the reason Michael Jackson is not represented on these somehow is also the reason that Janet Jackson can't use her last name.
That is possible. I was going to ask you whether she was trying to undergo some sort of rebranding.
I don't think so. I think it was
a
rights issue.
Rights to her own name?
Do you remember when Cody Rhodes, I'm sorry, I'm going to talk about wrestling for a second, but when he left the WWE, they kept the rights to his name and wouldn't let him use his last name in any other professional capacity. He just had to go by Cody.
Yeah, but that didn't happen to Janet Jackson. Janet Jackson wasn't in the WWE.
That's right. Yeah.
I mean,
she could have crushed though, I think.
Yeah, absolutely.
I'm not going to play every one of these million things or anything, but I'm going to play a couple more.
I want to know what other songs Cisco could have possibly hit. You know what? I bet they just didn't play it.
Because it was too obscene.
Because it was too risque. And they wanted 14-year-olds to be allowed to buy this CD off of the television.
When do you think was the height of the wearing of thongs? Like, when did it peak? When did it crest? Which is sort of a pun when you think about what a thong looks like.
I mean, have you done research? Are you quizzing me or just asking me to speculate?
I'm just asking you to speculate.
I think that thongs were most trendy. Now, I don't know if most worn per person in the population, that would be harder to say, but maybe easier to test.
Yeah.
But I think they were coolest in like 2000 exactly.
Okay, well, this was the year 2000. This Now That's What I Call Music Volume 5, the one we just heard, for what it's worth. And I guess the question of when thongs were worn most ubiquitously versus when it was coolest to have them be visible above your pant line is a different.
I don't think they are different things.
You don't think so?
I think they were coolest when they were visible.
You don't think there was a time, maybe even shortly after the visibility craze, when they became even more popular to wear, but just not? You think when it stopped being like, you have to have the whale tail, that, what a ridiculous thing. And then it's like middle school people wearing them.
Yeah.
That's so goddamn funny.
Yeah.
Are you familiar with the this meme that goes around in like right wing circles because they hate, I don't know, black people in general?
They hate everything.
But, there's this extremely photoshopped image of LeBron James like falling down on the court. And it's been photoshopped so it looks like he has a thong showing.
I'm not only completely unfamiliar with this.
Well, the right wing is
furious
about it.
But I didn't even imagine where it was going.
Well, that's where it was going. And the right wing was so mad at him for wearing a thong. It's such a stupid photo. It got such play. Hold on, I'm going to show you. I'll link to this as well.
Huh.
It looks like his pants have exploded to reveal a red thong. This had a lot of controversy.
I mean, it looks like is really overstating the quality of
it's
the
a terrible
photoshopping job that's been done here, but okay.
Yeah.
You would have to be a real fucking moron.
Yeah, that's right.
Just absolutely, like, you should be declared incompetent by the court.
Here's a, now that's what I call Music Volume 6, the commercial. Hell yeah.
Throw your hands up.
Yes.
Throw your hands up.
For now, that's what I call music.
Throw
six.
Your hands up. For now, that's what I call music. Volume 6.
Volume 6.
Oh yeah, when caught me freaking on the this that. He's freaking on everything, right?
Yeah.
Or is it fucking in the non-censored version? But they
I
do
think
freaking
so, yeah.
In the.
I believe so.
19 hits on one beautiful CD, including U2, Destiny's Child, Shaggy, and Backstreet Boys.
Oh my God! Yeah.
Samantha Mumba and Evan and Jaron, you'll be crazy.
Samantha Mumba might be the first one I don't believe I've ever heard of in my life.
When you order Now 6 with your credit card or by check debit, you'll also receive this limited edition Visor CD holder absolutely free.
Wow.
Wait no more to complete your collection.
It's worth noting that for me anyway, and I like went away to college in the year 2000. This is still 2000, for what it's worth, I think. Like, I know most of these songs, but this is the first one where I don't remember the commercial itself, right? The early commercials were iconic, but I don't remember this commercial, despite remembering the songs.
Well, once you go to college, you don't have TV on in the house
right,
all
yeah,
the time.
Yeah, exactly. And I think I'm going to come with a hot take here, especially because, like, his politics have been discredited and he's long been considered lame musically. But I think maybe U2 is sort of good, actually.
I mean, other than the fact that it's made 100,000 59-year-old men believe the Earth is flat?
I don't know about that.
Wait, sorry, did you just say YouTube is good?
No, U2, the band U2.
Okay. I might have significantly underestimated the number of middle-aged men that YouTube has made into flat earthers.
Well, YouTube,
as far as I know, hasn't done any of that.
Made a bunch of like blue MAGA people exist, basically. U2 is like the fucking guy. What's his name? What's his goddamn name?
Bono?
Bono. He's like a real lib in a way that is unpalatable. Not to alienate people, but I do think that they have some real bangers, actually. And I know what, I'm sorry, I'm going to use this opportunity to say the same thing about the Dave Matthews Band, who I think are considered lame in the same way that U2 is considered lame. I think they both have some bangers.
I guess I didn't understand that U2 was considered lamer than...
They're considered very lame, I think.
Are you sure about that?
No, but it's my current belief.
Call now to order Now That's What I Call Music Volume 6 with Coldplay, Lenny Kravitz, R. Kelly, and Jennifer Lopez.
Oh, what a song.
Wow.
God, that's a good song.
Yeah.
Oof, R. Kelly.
I Call Music Volume 6. Today's biggest artists and their biggest hits is back again.
Well, R. Kelly's in prison for like a long time now, right?
I think forever.
Now That's What I Call Music Volume 6 in your hands.
Oh, yeah. All of these songs are like, man, this is not an interesting podcast. It's just, it's basically me doing whippets. It's me over and over again being like, oh yeah, I forgot about that.
No, this rules. This is for us now, baby.
That thought.
I have a conspiracy theory for you, which is that Lenny Kravitz wearing that giant scarf, you may recall.
I do, yeah.
Was a false flag.
Okay.
To distract us from when Lenny Kravitz's pants ripped on stage and everyone could see his penis.
And he wanted everyone to talk more about his scarf.
His scarf than his available penis.
I mean, I have no knowledge that
I decided that the two main stories I knew about Lenny Kravitz, that one was a false flag to distract from the other.
Seems fair enough. All right. So you have done the research and prep for this, and I have not. But I did Google I used DuckDuckGo.
Well, that's the research I did, too. So you're just as prepared.
Well, while you were in the bathroom, so you've had a little more time than I did. But... what I've suddenly become most interested in is the one called Now That's What I Call Now. 100 hits from 100 nows. It's a best of Now That's What I Call Music.
Wow.
What the fuck is on that?
Someone needs to do the math on the sort of...
Now That's What I Call Now.
And if they're 20... ones on an album, then they could have done a bunch of these by now.
It's possible that that's a UK one also. I
okay, now that's what I call now 100 hits from 100 nows.
Now that's what I call now. 100 hits from 100 nows. A hit from every now album. From now 1 to now 100. An amazing 5 CDs. An incredible...
Blue made it on there. The thing is, like, 6 Britney songs should be on this, but there's no way they put that, right? They gotta pick... First of all, I've only heard, like, 3 of these before.
That's what I call now.
Yeah.
She freaking on the counter.
Unforgettable journey through 35 years of now.
Well, if you're going to pick one Britney song.
It's a good one. Oh, wow.
Yeah, that's a good song.
I would say Call Me Baby, like, is, you know, in retrospect, with this distance, feels like the end of an era that this sort of format would accommodate.
Say more about that.
I don't remember like a single getting as much attention since that point.
Like, was that the end of... So the, I guess my question is, was that the end of something happening in culture? Or was that just when you stopped being invited to party? Yeah, well, dance parties or whatever?
I mean, I started hanging with cooler people, maybe. Mm. Depends on your perspective. But no, it just felt like that was a single that everyone had heard. Man, woman, and child, old people, like they would just know that that was a popular single. Maybe it's when radio stopped being important.
What year do you think that song came out?
2009. 2012. Wow. Okay. Jeez. I almost knew you then.
Now. Almost.
Now, that's what I call now.
Like, what the fuck is that song? You're telling me that... Never fucking heard that shit. I don't know.
Was the Spice Girls one that we just heard on there? Was it Slam It to the Okay. Shake It to the Right? If you...
Yeah, that one.
Slam It, Shake It, etc.
Yeah. What are you? So I have a list of commercials for these videos that go all the way to basically current ones. Do you? What ones do you want to hear?
I mean, I'm curious to hear a current one, but I also, and the other. Besides, now that's what I call now.
Now that's what I call calling.
There's one called Now Number Ones, which presumably, I mean, that implies that it's what they think are the very best songs from the Now series.
I don't think this one is a commercial. There are like a lot of offshoots on this, like Christmas versions and, you know, various thematic variants. Is Jock Jams a
Jock
now?
Jams, you know, we should save that for a future episode of CD business, I
maybe.
Think.
Maybe. But you're implying that all of these are going to be about CDs. That's what you want to imply. All right. What? Give me a year.
I mean, should I pick a year after I, like, stopped existing socially and culturally? Or
I don't know. It's up to you.
Like, that was still marginal for me.
Up to you.
All right, let's do Now That's What I Call Music. Whatever came out in 2006. So I would have been in the middle of college, which means I went to parties and heard music, but did not see TV or listen to the radio.
Okay.
So I'm curious to know what's on that one. Whoa.
These are all encoded at wildly different volumes.
That's What I Call Music, volume 22.
I love this song. The right, the
yeah, it's pretty good. Bring it back to me. Cause you had a bad All right, well, Now That's What I Call Music. Is this 22?
This is 22.
All right, 22 is better than 21. Now 22 brings you all the chart-topping hits. I didn't realize Kelly Clarkson was so dominant as to be the Britney Spears of
this era.
Yeah.
Oh, Riding Dirty.
Mmm.
Now That's What I Call Music has everything you need from Neo and All American Rejects.
I'm also interested in how they decide which 3 seconds of a song to play.
Yeah, I mean, they must do extensive consumer panel testing of some kind. Because it needs to be a snippet of the song where you're like, oh,
absolutely,
yeah, that song.
Recognizable, yeah.
Well, they failed with that one for me.
Yeah, a lot of these, this is Nick
Lachey.
Wow,
Nick Lachey. Nick Lachey. Do you not know who Nick Lachey is?
He's married to Jessica Simpson.
Yeah, that's right.
How about, yeah, I know. I know about
culture.
Well,
then why did you think his name was Nick Lachey?
I don't know. I've never heard it out loud, I don't think. I'm going to play the last 2023 one. Or 2006 one.
There is no other.
There is no other. Now that's what I call music. Are you sure?
Of the hottest hits from some of your favorite superstar artists with Beyonce, Christina Aguilera, and Jessica Simpson.
I mean, am I just viewing this through the warping lens of time, but is Beyonce fundamentally not comparable to Jessica Simpson in 2006, or were they equivalent?
They're probably equivalent at that point, I would think.
Wow. Okay.
Wait, is Jessica Simpson dead?
Why do you keep saying shit like that?
I thought she... Oh, that's Anna Nicole Smith, right?
Oh my God.
Sorry. Wait, did I just do sexism?
Yeah.
Oh. I'm gonna have to cut that.
Yeah, don't keep that in there. What the fuck? First of all, Anna Nicole Smith died before Jessica Simpson became famous, I'm pretty sure.
I don't know. This is all a mess in my brain now, I think.
I can't do this anymore. I hate it. Everything's bad. I can't do this anymore.
All right.
Everything's bad.
I do, before we get too far down the road, I do want to say that Anna Nicole Smith died 10 years after Jessica Simpson became famous. Oh, so they did, okay. in fact, overlap for like 10 years of culture.
Does that
culture.
Excuse my...
No, oh, not okay. in any way.
I'm sorry.
I mean, they're I guess both they like, both had reality shows.
They were both like
probably in the same
era of like
where
a,
their thing was sort of like a dumb
right,
blonde.
That's like what our culture decided they were, right?
Yeah,
it's not crazy that I would confuse them, I don't think. And it's the media's misogyny, not my own. Do you want to hear a commercial for That's What I Call Music, Volume 87?
Sure, yeah. Is that arbitrarily chosen?
It's the last one on this playlist. Okay. Oh, no, we have got 89. We've got the most recent one, released in January 2024.
All right, well... I'm ready to hear some totally unfamiliar music.
Here we go.
Question is whether I will call it music.
Oh, I know that one.
All right, yeah. All right, these are... these are more familiar to me than I anticipated they might be.
Did you know? I only knew that second one. First of all, there's no voiceover from that guy.
Is he dead?
I don't know. These are only 30. These new ones are only like 30 seconds long, whereas the previous commercials were like a minute or two minutes long.
Yeah.
And so you really get like a second and a half of each song here.
Yeah.
Only that second one did I recognize personally.
I recognized a few of them, but well. Not in the sort of bone deep way of a sure. Backstreet's Back.
And you would have basically only like, I recognize it only because I probably heard it in a TikTok video now, which is also using
you watch TikTok and I do not.
Which is also only using like 3 seconds of it.
So this is actually, it's a perfect format.
It's a faithful
format.
Representation.
So yeah. Now... That's What I Call Music should start advertising itself as a TikTok.
As a library.
Clip library
for TikTok users. Yeah. Yeah. It's $1 million idea.
Damn. Wait. Don't tell
should
people
bleep
about
that
it.
Out?
Bleep that out.
Oh, I don't know how to bleep out shit.
Oh, you can leave
fuck.
It. I've had a couple. Oh, God. You.
Don't say the F word.
Go to
All right, let's conclude this.
All right, so in conclusion, what would you call music?
I guess like sonically fucking around. I mean, that you're. This is like a question that I've asked.
Well, you're
like,
a musicologist.
That I've asked first year general music lectures or like high school music classes. The answer really is who gives a shit.
I feel like people in my department were recently arguing on the internal like Slack channel about whether birdsong counts as music.
Oh, that is well trodden territory. That is
They're a bunch of biologists.
That's like a 40-year-old conversation within musicology at this point. And in fact, I think if we finally unpacked our fucking boxes of books, you would find
a book about it. You'd
find a Stephen Feld book about birdsong that is well within the musicology canon. Yeah. That's what I call music. What do you call music?
It's got a beat and you can dance to it.
That's what I'm going to put in the CD business theme song. Business. I don't have it on my pad, but it's playing right now because I'll add it later. CD business. Bye.
Boring talk about seats, CD talk between boys. Mind numbing chatter about ovules and spores. We'll dig a ditch and moan and split the CD business. It's CD business.